Is it really possible to use OpenBSD as a daily driver? It is. I did it for about a year and a half. Here are my thoughts. Hey, what's up? If you can't tell, I've moved into a new place. And that gives me the opportunity to redo my entire home network and build my dream private self-hosted infrastructure. That's actually how OpenBSD fits into this for me. It isn't just another OS to slap a window manager on and rice it to make it look pretty. Although I definitely enjoy doing that too. You could do it with just about any OS, but OpenBSD is what I've chosen for this iteration of my journey to take back control over my digital life. Because I don't know about you, but I'm not a fan of being tracked and monitored 24/7. If you watched my last video, you'll know that over a year and a half ago, I switched from Arch Linux to using OpenBSD as my full-time daily driver. And TLDR, I'm still obsessed with it. I like running it as a desktop, I like running it as a server. It's exactly what I wanted. A sane, secure OS that I can use for as much as possible. There's so much I love about it. There are a few things I dislike, and I'll cover those here too. But nothing that I can't either find a workaround for, turn to a positive, or just deal with, really. Firstly, just like learning anything new, there was a small learning curve. If you're coming from Linux, though, it isn't too bad. Which is good, because I don't really have as much time to invest in this stuff like I used to. I've got a full-time job, a girlfriend, and kind of a social life. But if I can do it, you can do it. Once you unlearn the Linux way of doing things, I actually found that OpenBSD is just as easy, if not easier, to learn and configure. What actually took the longest was unlearning the way I go about finding information. Because with Linux, it's easy to become reliant on all these outside sources of information. And that's a problem because there's just not as much content on the internet about OpenBSD as there is about Linux. There's plenty of support if you know where to look and how to go about it. But you can't always just jump on a search engine and find what you're looking for in the first Stack Exchange post. This is a plus and a minus to me, but mostly a plus, because it does force you to learn the proper resources that you need to go to when you're looking for information. The man pages really are very good. So good that it's ingrained in me now to search them first for any aspect of the system or programs that I'm trying to figure out. They've broken me of my default search engine habit that I had picked up in the Linux world. And I didn't even know I had that problem. It makes sense though. If the man pages don't have what you want after a certain number of times or a certain percentage of times, you're going to start your search for information elsewhere. The FAQ is very useful. It is almost as useful as the Arch Linux wiki. Anything you can't find in those resources, you can go search in the mailing list archives. So all the information is available, but you actually have to put in some brain work and figure things out based on the resources at hand. And this goes hand in hand with the mindset of OpenBSD. They have this mindset of RTFM to the fucking max. And it's a little bit elitist, but I like it. And not because it's hard or complex to configure. Like I said, it's pretty easy once you learn your way around. But it just isn't for low effort people. They assume that if you're using this OS, then you probably have some background knowledge of where it came from historically and why it exists. They're also assuming that you've been reading the documentation that they've already given you. So they are not always friendly to people who haven't put in the time to read the docs or the mailing list first, before trying to brain drain and info leech from other people. Nobody likes that. I'm all for information for newbies, but you cannot assume that someone else is going to do the learning for you. So I love this mindset. They call it a research OS, and they say it's specifically for the OpenBSD developers, aka, we build this for us, so stop complaining. They don't care how many features you want to see put into it. The core OpenBSD developers ultimately get to decide what goes into it. If you do want to see a feature, you can code it yourself or pay someone else to code it. But even then, it only might get integrated into the OS. This isn't Linux, where rogue devs can basically take over the entire direction of the project and try to turn it into bloatware. While we're on the topic of features, they also have this "don't add features we don't need" mindset, which I think is one of the things that sets them apart from every other OS and Linux distro out there. They are ruthless about keeping the system and its code lean while still making improvements, yet retaining the core utility of the OS and respecting the historic legacy of the OS. Of course, OpenBSD is touted for its security, and that's what got me looking at it in the first place. Security by default is nice, and I don't have to think too much about it. If I'm running a service on the internet, I just do. I mean, there's a couple of things I have to do first, for sure, but not as much, and it's easy to configure, and I can kind of rest a little easier running this OS. It's also nice and stable. There might be breaking changes here or there after a couple of releases, or I might have to learn a new feature or flag, but things aren't changing at breakneck speeds. Another nice thing though is if you don't want stable and you want to be on the cutting edge of the OS or the packages, you always have the option of running current or running a snapshot, which is similar to running a rolling release. I've started using this on my main desktop and laptop and I love it. It's also a true whole holistic operating system, and that makes it feel really nice and comfy. It definitely doesn't feel like it's a hodgepodge of utilities and packages that were slapped together like some Linux distros do. The project leaders and developers put a lot of thought into putting all the pieces into it from scratch for you. It's almost like the ease of Windows and Mac, but with the openness of Linux. It's hard to explain and is something you just have to experience. I don't have to go and pick every little package that I want for every little thing, and there's a logical, consistent file structure and organization, and there's a simplicity to all of its configuration. It feels like a real Unix, and that's because genetically it is. It isn't a rewrite. It's an actual fork off the 4.4 BSD Lite system from the Computer Science Research Group, the CSRG, at UC Berkeley. This is, of course, where it gets its name from, the Berkeley Software Distribution of Unix, or BSD. So it's a modern Unix, but at the same time, it's a retro Unix. I'm working on a system built by geniuses from decades past that, technically speaking, stretches all the way back to Dennis Ritchie, and I just find that really cool. And of course, no system D. I'm a simple man, I need simple tools that I can fully understand. As I mentioned in my last video, systemd can be great if that's how you want to run your system, but I don't need my systems to run more like macOS, which is what I feel like systemd wants to do and be. I don't like tools that do too much. I don't like magic, or at least computer magic anyway, which is probably why I don't like interpreted languages as much as I like compiled languages. Now this may all just be a lack of sophistication on my part, you know, I may not be at the level of understanding where I can really appreciate the beauty of systemd, but either way, it's not for me, and I'm loving the simplicity of the traditional BSD RC init system. Okay, so what software is available? It has most of the packages I need, and by that I mean almost everything I used on Linux is available for OpenBSD, plus some cool new things. They're also usually pretty up-to-date for the ones that I want. Especially during coronavirus, they were super up-to-date. But some software isn't available. The screencasting software OBS isn't available yet. It's a work in progress. And there are like two other things that I wanted, but that don't exist in packages right now that I can't really remember. But that's how few there are and how little it matters to me. OBS is one of those things that I've found a workaround for. I just run ffmpeg from the command line, which is what I would prefer to do anyway. I was just too lazy to do it before. So yeah, a couple things aren't available, and the other don't matter that much to me, or I found a workaround for it. And it gives me the opportunity to learn to build a port for OpenBSD at some point in the future when I find a package I want badly enough to basically get off my ass and do something about it. The project is small enough that I feel like I can contribute. I haven't yet, but I'm going to learn how to port things, I want to learn C and get good at C, and contribute to low-level drivers, security testing, and mitigations research. Talking about the software is, of course, only one piece of the puzzle. We have to talk about the hardware support. Now there's this myth, this pervasive myth, that the BSDs don't support a lot of hardware, and it isn't really true. Granted, they don't run on every ancient piece of hardware, and they don't run on every piece of hardware as soon as it hits the shelves, and yes, maybe after a couple years as well, but they do support a lot. It supports all my ThinkPads, it supports my NUC sitting on my desk here, running my beautiful 3440 by 1440 ultra-wide monitor. It supports my older AMD desktop with a Radeon graphics card, and newer ones as well. From what I understand, it does support AMD Ryzen CPUs as well, so I might be upgrading to that, who knows. Now keep in mind, I don't game at all, so if you do, you've got some extra research to do. But there's a whole subreddit for OpenBSD gaming that might be helpful here. Also, I know that almost nothing NVIDIA is supported, so if you've got that, it's a no-go. Keep that in mind. But just make sure to check that your hardware is supported before installing or building for OpenBSD or the other BSDs. You can throw it on a USB stick and boot from that and see what works and what doesn't. And you can also find the info in the man pages for the drivers for your hardware. This is also a case where a search engine will actually speed things up to help you find what you're looking for. Just search for the D messages, which will show you what hardware has been recognized by the OS. Another aspect of this is that some software that works fine on Linux may struggle or have weird issues on OpenBSD. Kdenlive works fine on my Arch desktop, but crashes on the exact same hardware when I'm using OpenBSD. Now, this doesn't happen often, but I have this one anecdote, so I know that it happens, and it may be a bug. I don't know. I either find workarounds, find better compatible hardware, wait for a new snapshot or something like that, or I can just realize that I can do 99.8% of the things that I need to do on OpenBSD, and I can do the other 0.2% on a different OS. There's no rule against that. One legit complaint that I've seen online that I pretty much agree with is when it comes to Wi-Fi. OpenBSD doesn't support the latest wireless standards. Right now, realistically, it's just 802.11n. Now, from what I understand, the new standards are complex and the project doesn't have the developer resources to put towards that at the moment. So I have no idea when or if they're going to move forward on this, but for now, I don't care. Because unless I'm sitting on my couch or something, I'm always using an Ethernet cable. Also, I love old ThinkPads, and some of them can't even do 802.11ac yet, and N seems plenty fast enough. But I'd still like the option for better wireless speeds on devices that can support it. From some anecdotes, OpenBSD may not be as fast as Linux, but in my experience, I don't actually notice any speed issues, except for JavaScript-heavy websites in a heavy browser. Now, the main impetus for this complaint is Firefox. Firefox speed is atrocious right now on OpenBSD, even for my low standards for what I expect from a browser. Now, don't get me wrong, I am and have been trying to minimize my GUI browser usage and move more towards the command line, because I've heard other people say this, and I 100% agree, that I don't think a computer should just be a bootloader for your browser. I think that's pretty lame. And I actually think there are privacy reasons to move away from giant browsers anyway. But that's besides the point. Firefox has long been the browser that I grab when I'm using a GUI browser on a new install. And like I said, it's pretty damn slow on OpenBSD right now. It's weird because I remember when I first started using it a few releases ago, it was fine. I didn't have this problem. And now it's bad no matter if I put it on my desktop or my laptop, no matter what settings I do, no matter if I'm using a recent snapshot or whatever. So for now, I'll go grab Iridium or Chromium from packages and they do better. Now they may not be as peppy as on Linux, I'm not sure, but they're very usable. And it does push me even more towards figuring out my minimalist browsing setup with W3M and the suckless surf browser anyway. Okay, let's talk about Bluetooth support, of which OpenBSD has none. I actually don't use Bluetooth that often on most of my machines because I'm usually close enough that I can use a wired pair. And I actually do that on Linux as well since I can't stand having my battery die on my headphones, only to wind up using a wire anyway. But I actually fixed this issue, or found a workaround anyway. This guy posted one online. I just use a USB to Bluetooth dongle and pair it with my Bluetooth headphones. Yes, it isn't as nice as having it built in, and I doubt it's running open source software, but I highly doubt that little guy is doing anything nefarious, and even if I was really paranoid about it, I don't keep it plugged in all the time, and of course I can monitor my traffic for malicious packets anyway. The next issue isn't exactly hardware. It's the file system. There are so many people online that complain about this, and I'm not exactly sure why. I'm also amazed at how many file systems experts come out of the woodwork whenever this is brought up. And they're all very sure that they're right, and they're all saying the same things. OpenBSD uses the ancient FFS, and now the FFS2 fast file system. To my petty human brain, I really can't tell if this is a problem. I don't notice any speed issues at all. Now, I don't know a ton about file systems, but I've never needed to, and that's kind of my point. It doesn't matter to me, and it hasn't been an issue at all. Of course, I've used plenty of types of file systems in my Linux days, and on Linux systems for work, but even then, I don't need to go too deeply. So this may be an area of ignorance for me, but I don't think it matters that much to me the way I use my machines. Would I like a journaling file system? Sure, I guess. But I haven't had any problems without one. And I feel like most of the problems in this area would be handled by good data hygiene anyways. I can back up my systems properly, protect them against bit rot, use a UPS for them, and then if they do crash, I don't mind if they run an FSCK. I'm not a zealot on this though. I've run ZFS on my Proxmox server for years, but that's just because that's supposedly a great safe file system for that purpose. I'll dig more into file systems at some point to see if I'm wrong on this stuff, but for now it isn't an issue to me, or at least it doesn't seem to be. I'm sure at least a few of the things that I've mentioned here probably hold true for the other BSDs as well, so there's no need to try and start a flame war in the comments about it or anything. I haven't used all of them, I haven't used all of them very much, and I don't plan to use them as much as OpenBSD. I do plan on digging into them as well, at least a little bit. In fact, Kirk McCusick, one of the FreeBSD project leaders, has some really good looking courses that are super expensive, but they look really good, that I would like to go through, and they teach you the guts of a BSD system. But OpenBSD is still the one for me. After a little over a year and a half, I am still enamored with this OS. Now, I'm not trying to be a bug man about it. I'm definitely not someone who is defined by my operating system. I just see myself using it for a long time to come. Using it teaches me a lot of things. So I keep getting better, and over the releases, it keeps getting better too. We're all growing together. It's a beautiful thing. So like and subscribe and grow with me. I'll have more OpenBSD specific content in the future, as well as technically OS agnostic stuff as well. And remember, just because you're paranoid doesn't mean they aren't out to get you. See you next time.